Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to, I think, our second Fieldwide Plenary Residencies Connect of this year. And this one is titled Future Climates. Really excited to bring this incredible roster of speakers into conversation and to have a chat about future climates. This is going to be a really interesting and I believe a meandering conversation, but really excited to have it. Before we get started, I'd like to take a moment of silence and stillness to honor Black lives and the Black lives that have been lost over the past year and a half. As many of you know, I am Lisa Funderburk-Hoffman. I'm the Executive Director of the Alliance of Artist Communities. I am calling in from Providence, Rhode Island, the sacred lands of the Narragansett, Wampanoag, and Niantic. I acknowledge that the United States land seizures and colonization of Providence were a project of physical and spiritual destruction that denied the Narragansett, Wampanoag, and Niantic peoples free and unhindered access to the land that fundamentally shapes their identity and spirituality. We pay respects to the Narragansett, Wampanoag, and Niantic peoples, both past and present. Please consider the many legacies of violence, displacement, and settlement that bring us together in each of our places today. We acknowledge the past, present, and future generations of the nations who have stewarded this land, as well as honor and celebrate this place. Before we dive into today's conversation, we have a few housekeeping notes and rules of engagement. So bear with me. For some of you, this will be familiar. For some of you, this will be new. Firstly, this session is being recorded. All participants are set to mute. Live captioning is enabled for the session. As Flannery explained at the beginning, you can hover over the CC transcript in order to be able to view that live transcript. And also, I want to acknowledge that you can actually move that around anywhere you want to on the screen once you identify it. We have two ASL interpreters, Jesse Baskin and Asia Paplo, that are assisting us today with ASL interpretation. You have the choice to use speaker or gallery view for the purposes of this call. It's your choice. It will enable you either to see the speaker or your colleagues. It doesn't matter to us. It's whatever makes you most comfortable, and feel free to keep your camera on or off. If you have a question, we ask that you please use the chat box that's being monitored by the AAC staff. There may be some time at the end for Q&A. However, we ask that you do practice chat box etiquette, and please try to avoid cross conversations and a lot of different dialogue. It can be distracting to some of our presenters as well as other participants. Due to the size of this call, as many of you know, after operating a full year in this virtual world, that we may experience some type of interruption to power or be disconnected. Know that we are monitoring all of those channels actively and carefully. And if at any moment we are disrupted or disconnected for any reason, we will log off and log back in. But also, if any of our moderators or panelists freeze or get disconnected during the call, just hold tight and we'll be doing everything we can to resume the session. At the end of this session, you'll receive a Residencies Connect feedback survey. Please fill that in. You all have been really, really excellent and wonderful with sending in your pre-questions and filling out your feedback surveys and questionnaires. This has been really useful and helpful in guiding and informing AAC programming. So we ask that you continue that practice as we go forward. And lastly, we ask that you continue to contribute to any resources for any topic that we bring forward. As many of you know, that we started Residencies Connect at the start of the COVID-19 pandemic. It has been something that we felt was important and a way for us to connect with our membership and the arts community at large. So any information, resources on any given topic that you are able to share and bring forward, we do bring that into our resource library and we greatly appreciate it. So please do not be afraid to share information if you have it. And likewise, we will be sharing information with you after this call. If you are given the opportunity to speak, we ask that you just be respectful and being aware of the valuable commodity of time. We have a good chunk of time together, but we know that time goes by rather quickly. Keep the specific topic and question in mind. I say this also because yes, we have a really big topic today and we received a lot of different questions on that, but we will have to hone that in and have somewhat of a focus be able to get through the conversation. So if you're given the opportunity to ask a question or make a statement or contribute, please try to stick to the topic. If it's not covered here today, you probably more than likely will see it come up in a learning opportunity in the future. So be on the lookout for that. There is no networking opportunity at the end of this call, but be on the lookout for future Residencies Connect when you'll have a chance to network with your colleagues and peers at the end of other sessions. And at the end of the session, we may invite you to share your contact information so that we have your updated information also so that your colleagues will be able to see it as well and stay in contact outside of the Alliance of Artist Communities. So let's get started. We've got an incredible panel here today, and I'm really, really excited. I'm off of caffeine for a few days, so I'm also really foggy. So I'm just going to bring that into the space and let you all know. So I'm really, really excited because I'm with a group of four people that some I have known for a little bit longer, others that I'm just getting to know through other relationships that are really sharp and really deep thinkers and bring a lot of really different perspectives to this idea of climate, the climate crisis, climate change, and climates in general. As many of you know, here at the Alliance, we have been talking a lot and using the word climate, and we use the word climate in a multitude of ways. But as of late, we have been discussing how to create climates where your artists, your staff can thrive. But we also acknowledge that when thinking about climate, we're not only talking about the environment and the way that you exist in a particular space, but we are talking about how does climate impact our lives in terms of climate change, the climate crisis, and thinking about the environment, environmental degradation. And we want to just bring those two domains into conversation. We want to think about it in terms of one, how it affects the people in terms of being a hosting and a presenting organization, but also what is the opposite, the other side of this, what is this to be in relationship with the land and with the earth, and what is your role in doing that? And this is big, it is wide, it is important. It will go across many domains, but we're just going to try to get somewhere today, knowing that this conversation is not going to cover the whole topic or every bit of piece of it, but just to open a door to future interrogations. So I was thinking about this because once upon a time, many of you know, I worked in ecology, and that was my field of practice. I always tell everyone I'm a scientist by training, and my greatest pleasure is being outside. And I also believe right now we are experiencing probably the biggest existential crisis of our time, which is the climate crisis. And this is something that in my work through the Alliance, in my work working directly in a residency program, working in an urban nature museum, that you can't help but notice and acknowledge that not only does this crisis exist, but there is a disconnect in terms of how we think about climate, climate change, climate justice, environmental justice, and racism. There is this huge span that exists. There's a way that we talk about it. There's a way that people are engaged in the conversation, and there are ways that people are not included in the conversation. And I'll just share a really quick antidote is that as a person with my level of experience and training, I have been the last person on the invite of a list of of as a person of color invited to talk about the environment, the effects of environmental racism by all white groups when they want to talk about ways that we can do better to interface and engage with those groups. And that shows you that when we talk about the earth, when we talk about the land, when we talk about being in relationship with the land, that it is still very much guided and girded by white supremacist thinking. It is still very much guided by thinking that it belongs to one group versus another. There is very much a lack of acknowledgement that we all are living on stolen land, right? That this is not our land, this is land which we occupy, but that was not given to us. And I find that really interesting. So I'm really excited to start to open up this conversation a little bit and start to talk about what does this mean and what does this mean through the context of residencies, where land is something that holds us all kind of together. So Mary, and I'm not going to introduce each one of our presenters, and maybe Aweege will tell me I should have and do that, but we have four great presenters. Setu Jones, he's a multidisciplinary artist, advocate, and maker based in St. Paul, Minnesota. Setu, wave and say hello. There we go. We have Stefan Jackson. He's the founder of Natural Defense LLC, a consultancy specializing in diversity and inclusion for natural resource conservation organizations, while advising on all aspects of nonprofit management. Stefan, say hello.
Hello.
We have Ivan Gallardo, is an arts and cultural consultant that is dedicated to honoring and valuing artists as critical components of a successful society. Ivan, say hello. And we have Mary Bordeaux, who serves as the First Peoples Fund's vice president. She received her bachelor's from the Institute of American Indian Arts and MFA from the University of Arts. But what I want to say is that Mary is also a practicing artist and has held curatorial positions. So we have a multidisciplinary lens coming with Mary. Mary, say hello to the group, please. Okay, so Mary, I want to start with you. And I think, you know, I think you could really ground this conversation and lead us into a wonderful space. I told you this during our prep call that I've been infatuated with a poet, and he always says the most work we can do is figure out how to ask the beautiful question often in unbeautiful times. And I think you led us down a road of interrogation and thinking with some of the words that you shared with us about collective action and relationships. And I just was hoping that you would bring that into this room, some of the questions that you use to guide your work and how that came to be.
Thanks, Lisa. And hi, everybody. I'm nervous to be here, but I'm excited to be here. And I, you know, we met on Tuesday, was it Tuesday? Yes. And I just think one of the things I was thinking about at that time and in the conversation is in, and I might start a little different, but you know, I growing up as a Lakota person, my family always asked us, family was always important. And even when family was hard, my mom and my grandma would be like, oh, well, that's your relative. We have to help them. We have to, you know, work with them and do what they need. And my mom always tells me, you always help people until they can help themselves. And so, and that's hard. And, you know, so I carried this kind of teaching and ideas with me my whole life. And I'm a doctorate student, so I've been doing a lot of research on what Lakota, like what it means to be Lakota and how are we the way we are as Lakota people. And so in my research, I was reading Ala Deloria, and she articulates it in her kinship section of her book, Speaking of Indians. She says that the aim of Dakota people's life is to be a good relative. And I was like, Oh, that's what it is. You know, that's what it's, but that's what it is. Be a good relative. That's what my grandma and my mom have been telling me my whole life, is to be a good relative. And so, you know, as I've grown over the years and learned, and as I do my work, I ask myself this question all the time. What does that mean to be a good relative? What does it mean to be a good relative when I'm buying a home, or when I'm buying land, or when I'm renting? What does it mean to be a good relative when, as a vice president of a nonprofit? What does it mean to be a good relative when it's hard, and when you're working with people or spaces that you don't necessarily fit in? What does that mean? How do I be a good relative to myself? What does it mean to take care of myself as a good relative and support people, but also not be an enabler of, or supporting things that maybe are putting me in uncomfortable situations, or in putting me maybe in danger? So, you know, what does it mean? How do I be a good relative? How do I be a good relative when I'm in a space about philanthropy with philanthropists? How do I be a good relative when I'm working with community and I'm asking them to give of their time and their energy? How do I be a good relative to my son's school? You know, what does that mean? And so, you know, just always asking myself this question: how do I be a good relative to the land? How do I be a good relative to mosquitoes, because there are flies? You know, those things are all important to and thinking holistically. And how do you do that? How do you think holistically? How do you think collectively? How do you move? How do you make sure that you're not doing this alone, right? That's being a good relative, that you're not doing it alone. Mm. One of the things I always admire about the president of First Peoples Fund, Lori Puir, and I don't think this is like a conscious practice of hers, or maybe it is, but I don't think she could articulate it to anybody. But I, you know, working with her for the last 15 years, I worked with her before I worked for her organization, but she never does anything by herself. She always always brings somebody with her. When she's meeting with a funder, when she's meeting a new community, when she has an interview, you know, she always brings somebody with her, because she understands that her voice isn't always the only one that needs to be heard. So, you know, how does she work collectively? And so, you know, just always asking myself these questions and making sure that it's like a balancing act too, right? How do you work within these systems that don't work for us, because that's what we have right now, but also be a good relative at the same time?
Yeah, you know, Mary, I want to say I really appreciate that. And it really resonated with me, because I asked myself that question like several more times over the past couple of days. Like, I'm just like, and I realize, and I've got a number of folks on this call, is like, it was actually no answer that was really rising up. But I felt like there was a change. There was somewhat of a change in my posture or state of being. It almost felt like, I don't know, I think of my grandmother, it was almost like a prayer, right? Like, you know, it was almost in a way of asking for some level of mercy or some grace or some way to just hold the moment, to be able to notice some things that I hadn't noticed before. And I guess the other thing is just, you know, often the time we can get on these calls and we can get down to some really pragmatic things where people want to know, okay, so how does this make my residency different, right? Like, or what do I do about my land? Well, how do I tie this back to my land acknowledgement? And I just want to clarify and say very plainly for this group, is this a question that you look to answer? How does it show up? How does it reveal itself to you?
So I don't know. There's not all. It's not the same answer every time, right? Every time it's not the same answer, and because life is complicated, life is hard sometimes. And I think, you know, for Lakota people, we have a phrase, Mataki Oyasin, right? that loosely translate to we're all related, and not just meaning human to human, but human to non-human as well, and human to land. We're all related, and it's kind of this prayer, like you said. But what it, you know, I asked this only so I could be better, so I could be a better person, and I can interact with the world in a better way. So I understand my responsibilities and my obligations to the world, to everything, to human, non-human. And you know what? Sometimes, like, you don't get it right, but you know, you have to keep trying, right? You have to figure out how to be a better relative. And that's why you don't do it alone either, because some people help you be like, okay, I get, like, I'm having trouble with interacting with the city. And right. So like, okay, how do I be a better relative? And maybe I'm not the person to be in this conversation, and maybe I can invite somebody in that has maybe some more patience and can have that conversation. So, and maybe being a better relative means stepping out of a situation, because you need to be a good relative to yourself. And that's why I said it's like this balancing act. It's never the same answer. It's never like it's, and it's always, because it's a balancing act, you have to give somewhere, and you have to, it's a give and take all the time. So I don't think you, you can, and even Ala Deloria says in her book, it's, we strive for it, right? We always work towards being a good relative as Dakota people. And so, like, I just think there isn't an answer, but there's always, like, it's always a process, right? It's part of it.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that. With that, Stefan, I'd like to invite you into the conversation, and if you'll unmute, I have a question for you, because you work with conservationists, and you work with people who are working to conserve and preserve natural spaces for years and years to come. And I'd imagine that doing that work, especially through a diversity, equity, access, and inclusion lens, and working in that particular capacity, that relationship, being a good relative, can be somewhat, I don't know, at times fraught. Tell us a little bit about your experience with being in relationship with these organizations, and also maintaining your authentic relationship with the land and your identity. A little something for you.
So I came into a career in conservation following law school. I graduated in 1995, and between my first and second years of law school, I did a 10-day solo backpacking trip in the Wind River Range in Wyoming. Nearly killed myself four or five times. And so I sort of thought I knew that I needed that kind of connection. I had been my family and friends of our family had at a young age made sort of impressionable imprinted me with the need to connect with nature, which is certainly arguably a primal drive, but we're so detached culturally, or we can be that way, and then I mean, it's just, and I'm not even talking about specifically, let's say my racial culture or my racial identities and the cultures there. I'm talking about just as a nation, mostly because, and this gets to some, one of the big points that I went to work for the Nature Conservancy, following some work with the National Outdoor Leadership School, and in every space I've occupied over the last 35 years, until probably the last five of those, I've generally been the person of color in this space. I still am the only person that was ever hired by the main Nature Conservancy to work with the staff of 35 over a course of 12 years. And I haven't worked for them in 12 years. So it's or 10 years. So the what comes to mind is that these entities cities in our nation, you know, we use these words. It's hard to find the language. And this is why I'm really pleased you had me, you the honor of following Mary, because now I had a revelation, in her talk of kinship the other day. And it really has started to, I was talking to some friends in a nonviolent communications workshop, and it resonated through that, that the hard part for me in conservation of 35 years and in conceptualizing and staying in that in the workspace is the violence that you know you're doing. It's the reality that what you are participating in is a machinery, just one sector of the nonprofit industrial complex that is particularly focused in on the attributes of dominion, control. You know, it's around ownership, property, control, and everything from terraforming. You know, we call things like restoration or reparation or whatever, you know, what various ways that we will use our culturally, again, we'll use our words and our science to justify, again, a lot of that dominion, you know. Mm. And so it's in what we think of as a general good, but again, who are the people in the organizations that are making those decisions about what those global priorities? I mean, the Nature Conservancy sits down and sets global priorities for what it does. At various points, it's in the top 20 of the largest charities in the United States. It's it owns millions of acres, not just here in the U.S., but actually, you know, across the world. So it's just, and it is a private, you know, it's a private nonprofit organization, you know, so it's not subject to any real control from citizens in any space that it occupies and works. And they're not, and it's just one example of all the dominant organizations in conservation, be it the Sierra Club or the Wilderness Society and so on and so on. So it's just, it's a tough space to be in. It's a good call. I mean, it really is. It was always hard. But I have to say this language, wow. Because the tough one for me has been stewardship and conservationist and preserve and reserve and wanting to do, and caretaker, all of whom have other kinds of connotations that just never felt as good as that, as the idea of kinship. So it really does resonate. It feels like the most natural way to approach it. So. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, you know, Stefan, I agree with you on the language, right? The language piece, and I think it's something difficult to reconcile. And then you're in it, and then one day you wake up and you have this moment, and you realize that the time is now to say something or do something or act differently for artist communities and artist residencies, in particular. They were started in the 1800s. In Europe, and they were originally called artist colonies, and this idea of the colony persisted in the language to the point up until last year, like the active use of the word colony was still littered on our website and, you know, artist colonies, and it opened up this wide conversation. And what it highlighted for me is, one, just the lack of knowledge around scientific racism, this idea of the roots and the knowledge of the word of colony and colonization and what it means and what it has always meant, and then how it has been used and applied to make sense in other contexts, but also how loyal people are to this language in order to actually be able to defend that space, to be able to hold onto that space or to preserve one's individual's names, and how contentious it actually becomes and how it can be weaponized. And it's a hard space to be in, right? Because you know, you're a person of color, you're in these all white spaces, you're trying to do something for the greater good. You know that, you know, out of all the work that you're doing, you're this one sliver, but at the same time, you have to bring it forward. And I was curious, and after we talked the other day, because I was like, well, how do you reconcile this? Because we're having you're obviously having conversations with people who are living, occupying and now conserving and preserving stolen land with zero acknowledgement of that. But how do we exist? And where does that go? And what's the hope for the change? I have to ask you that question, and I know we didn't prep for that, but I'm just curious because it's a thing.
Yeah. I have to begin individually. I have to think about it and engage with it organizationally in the work that I do. Mm-hmm. And then certainly acknowledge and recognize that there are systems, right, that hold these things in place. The same skill set, and this is actually another piece that it helps me slide right into one of the pieces that I wanted to speak of regarding climate change. It's so much of my work is about resilience, right? That's what it is. It's about helping folks manage trauma, deal with various levels of unaddressed trauma. And it's sort of in the answer to that. It's that I've had to find ways to address as many people of color do. I have a Scottish heritage that I can trace all the way back to Robert the Bruce. My family name's Crawford and Randolph, huge plantation owners, friends of Andrew Jackson's, mm-hmm. Trail of Tears. I mean, there's just so much violence on one side of my family against quite against the other side of my family or my ancestry. And reconciling that within me, because there's a certain part of me that has, I want to be here. I need to be in this space. And this is often what I have to translate to. I want to be here to do good works, to hopefully help create a better world for my kids. That's how I see it. And have them be able to build off of what I'm doing, because so often with these organizations and in this space, there have been attempts made to support and change names and change language. And then they've been able to, give it five, no more than 10 years, and they all forget. Mm. And that's really sort of, it's a common practice, culturally, but it's very much in the space of conservation. There are always attempts. There have been multiple attempts in my tenure, trying to address the disparities and inequalities. But for myself, it's just the same idea of trying to address some of that trauma, address the realities, face my own history, face the fact that I find a great deal of, I guess my own resilience, my own ability to self-care and healing comes from working with organizations where I feel a stronger affinity for me across a spectrum of affinity. So if it's supporting, my outdoor Afro, the folks that are outdoor Afro coordinators here in Maine, who are part of another entity that we created here to develop future, sort of leaders and in climate change, but specifically, that's one part of my rejuvenation. The other side is to work in this sort of bringing the white dominant culture along, the organizations that occupy the power and control of these resources. So but I think you have to address it. You have to do, I mean, you called it out, and we just have to keep calling it out, because Otherwise, what folks have been able to do in those spaces is exactly as you described. They've been able just to go about their business, to close deals, to operate as, violently in many ways as their own ancestors did, and yet not be, and that's been, they've been praised for it and elevated in those organizations for it. And that's what has to change.
Yeah. So I really appreciate that. Thank you, Stefan. And I've got a little bit more that I want to come back to on that. I want to get Yvonne in here because I think what this also brings to it, it's also, there are two things that come to mind for me. It's the performance that you alluded to, Stefan, and this idea of you can change your name, you can put out a statement, you could actually change some language, and there's a certain performative nature to doing that work. But it doesn't have what we consider the stickiness. I don't think there's a person of color that is on this call or in this room that doesn't note or acknowledge a time when they have had to be witness to a statement or the use of language in such a way that they had to bend their ear or be a part of, even though it wasn't their invitation, but they knew that implicated them in some particular way. And Yvonne, you started to talk a little bit about this with the organizations that you're working with and getting at that performance. And that is something that I should just admit it. I'm just struggling every single day, right? Like every day in some capacity, there's something that I'm interrogating or questioning. But, we open conversations and we give land acknowledgements. I'm comfortable giving a land acknowledgement. I have Indigenous roots. I am Unkachug and Pusatuk, and that is part of my family history. But I often think when I'm in other spaces, when it says, and someone writes me and they say, can you give me a sample of your land acknowledgement? I'd like to use it. And, or if someone says to me, that was a beautiful land acknowledgement. I'm saying, are land acknowledgements beautiful? I'm not sure right now. I'm not even understanding. Are they beautiful? Or then someone says, well, let's open the meeting with this Indigenous way of communicating. And I'm like, but you're not Indigenous and you're asking me to facilitate that. So there gets to be a performance of it. Yvonne, can you help me? Like, just tell me what you're seeing, how you're addressing and tackling, because I know you're getting at this with some groups and I know you've seen it and experienced it, but I'd love to hear from you.
Yes. Wow. Thank you. Well, I am only going to further the very necessary need for complexity in this work. And I'm sorry, but there is, we are being called to think outside of what has been a limiting and inadequate framework that is binary. Mm. Every way you can imagine how binaryism works, that is antithetical to how we live our lives. I are in relationship to self and others. And so I think Stefan mentioned it, Lisa mentioned the cognitive dissonance that we are all experiencing. As we become more aware of the need for greater equity, and that includes cultural equity, racial equity, gender justice, we find a greater tension within ourselves, within the spaces that we work. So I am working with a number of diverse organizations, from large institutions to small community, culturally specific organizations, to national folks around advancing greater cultural equity, diversity, equity, and inclusion. And one of the things we keep getting stuck at in these relationships is that folks want a simple, comfortable solution or answer, right? I get brought in and I have to make very clear, I am not here to give you an answer. I am here to help all of us ask better questions. and where that's led us, what has informed that approach for myself is my own culture and experience within this concept called Latinidad. It is complex, it is diverse, it is not a monolith. It is oftentimes in contrast to US context, right? We are forced to think globally because we cannot just think about race or identity or ethnicity or relationship to land within you know, what we've been taught in this country. So the need for that level of sophistication is, I would say, dire, because if we keep working within this binary, which I feel is, you know, a very scarcity approach to thinking and this work, we are not going to move into the change work that we need to hold everyone. So, you know, Latinidad also has its own relationship to land historically and presently. My family comes from the East Los Angeles Boyle Heights area here. My grandparents came 1906, and then we have first gen immigrants, right? Like, so different, so many different experiences to and relationship to land, where oftentimes we have had to forget our relationship to land. We have been forced to migrate. We have been forced because of climate, economic, you know, war. We have been forced to move from original homes and land and that relationship. My father comes from a detribalized Apache and Yaqui communities, and what that whole process did, right? Separation of land, separation of culture. So when we talk about land acknowledgement or land back movements, it's not just about the land. It is about lost lives. It's about lost traditions, language, and culture. And so this work that we're doing in, that I'm doing with organizations, you know, the performance that happens from everyone in these spaces, I think only furthers the reductive comfort level, right? Like, we need to feel comfortable with this. We need to feel like we're in control. We need to feel like we can hold all of this and pave a path forward. But as Mary mentioned, it is this work is about the process. This work is not comfortable. It is a constant balancing act. It is a constant tension. And I think that's what I've learned, and Mary and others who we work with, the Intercultural Leadership Institute. It's very, if we think about it symbolically, our ability to live and work together and do change work together is a constant tension, a constant balance of cultural humility, action, awareness. And that's not unlike, you know, when we think of the borderlands, right? Mm-hmm. If you identify as a fronteriza, that you are in constant tension with this border, this geopolitical, right, enclave. And yet that's home. That is your home. And so that tension, I think, really reflects kind of how we need to be in these spaces in authentic ways, or just bringing our whole selves to them. And it also, I think, reflects the greater complexity in these conversations, whether it's undoing racism, you can't undo racism without undoing capitalism, as the great Ruth Wilson Gilmore has said. And so all of these tensions, I think we have just leaned into comfort a little too much. And so we're really defaulting back to that approach, and it's not serving the change work that we need to see now.
Yvonne, I appreciate that so much, because I think you got right at it, that when we start talking about a land back movement, we start talking about land acknowledgments, we start talking about repatriation, these are all methodologies, but singularly in the absence of considering, and you said it should be the lost lives, traditions, language, and culture, they just don't hold it. I mean, it just we can't continue this system of erasure and not acknowledging that literally, you know, there has been a genocide and multiple genocides, and that erasure has happened. And we not only have to acknowledge it, but we have to stop repeating it. It's time for me to bring you into this, because I think the work that you're doing right there in St. Paul starts to get at that. And it's obviously through an arts and cultural lens, but it's also through a very much a historical lens. It is very much through an environmental and ecological lens. But tell us a little bit about your work and what you're doing in this place. I mean, and you've done it before, and you're doing more. So talk to us a little bit about that.
Thank you, Lisa. And I need to give a big shout out to all the 80 plus folks who are here with us in this room. Welcome. And you have been a part of, all you all folks who are out there listening to the three previous panelists before me had been blown away. It blows me away to be here. I describe this as in this grand Afro-Atlantic tradition of improvisation, in particular in music and art, how all these folks are these band members that share this same background, the same musical background. And so we're just like riffing on these same notes. And so I can only echo what folks said before me. I also need to give a big shout out to the Alliance and for the work that they're doing and bringing us together. A special shout out to Lisa and her work on transforming this organization. I mean, this is rare to have an African-American woman who is leading this organization. This is like, you are our Jackie Robinson in a way here. and you're hitting home runs. You're hitting home runs here. Now, kind of an answer and to reflect and to resonate what has been said before, you know, I'll give you some of my street cred. I am a fourth generation Minnesotan. My great grandfather, born in slavery in Kentucky, freed himself, fought in the Civil War, ended up in Minnesota in 1877, were earned enough to go back to farming, served as a porter in a hotel. The hotel still stands. And moved to Rochester, Minnesota, where he operated a farm where my grandmother was born. Now, that is the last link that my family had to this open space. And since that time, with my father's generation, my grandmother's children, they really worked to give my generation the foundation, the strength, and the tools to be able to battle this racist world that they knew that we were going to have to face. Part of that, and I say this all the time, from the men and the women in my family, I learned how to love self. I learned how to love family. They were really important. It was really important for them to be a part of community. So they loved community and they loved the earth. Mm-hmm. And so I grew up in this family of these, my father and his brothers and sisters, these crazy, mad environmentalists. They never would have called themselves that, but we were always outside. They were these crazy, mad fishermen. And that's, I also need to give a big shout out to my fishing buddy, Lisa. I was telling folks a couple days ago that I was going fishing yesterday, and I did. And of course, I didn't catch anything, but it was important to be there and to be blessed and to take in the Japanese context, to take a bath in the forest, to take a bath mm-hmm. in the river, and to have that wash over me. Mm-hmm. But I had this great love that was imposed upon me. And despite being a part of this cultural revolution that we describe, at least that's the way we described it, in the late 60s and early 70s, I was a part of the Black Arts Movement that was the cultural component of the Black Power and the Civil Rights Movement. And we dedicated our work at that time to really changing the world and changing the world dynamic. But, and so I was introduced to Marxist-Leninist thought. I was introduced to Islam, to Buddhism, to Jimi Hendrixism, all of these things that impacted me, all of those different philosophies, but they were all laid on top of this foundation of love that I got from my family, and this love of the world. And so that is how that's the foundation that I use to create work from and to extend into. Most recent, and I would say, if y'all wanna see my work, go to my website, check it out. You know, I'm not gonna spend a lot of time describing it. And fortunately, there's enough there. But one of the things that isn't mentioned is this recent work I've been doing. When I was a kid, I had an auntie, my Auntie Beverly, who used to call me Little George Washington Carver. And as 5 or 6, George Washington Carver is such an icon today in the idea of botany, of extension, of university extension. I mean, all of that is such an icon that I knew who he was at 5 or 6. And my first reaction was like, and of course I didn't say this to Mom Beverly, but like, why would I want to be like that old bald-headed man? And here I am, that old bald-headed man, carrying through his ideas about extending and about understanding where we are in the natural world and working on ways to manage it and to work with it. A lot of folks don't know that George Washington Carver was an artist, and that's really how he got into the study of botany, because he painted nothing but plants. And somebody told, one of his instructors said, well, you need to study plants. And so the rest is history. He never stopped painting. One of the things that George Washington Carver did as well, and a lot of folks don't know this, is that he used the natural environment to create pigments and paints and stains, creating over 73 different pigments from the earth. One of the things he did, and I'm going to wind up here, one of the things he did was reinvent Egyptian blue. The formula for Egyptian blue had been lost since the time of the pharaohs. And I mean, we can see it in Egyptian art, see that brilliant blue. Well, folks had forgotten how to make it. One of the few things that George Washington Carver did was patent it. And one of the few things that he patented was the process for Egyptian blue. So I have been using and integrating that blue in my work over and over again most recently. And one of the things that I ask you all to do is to go to my website and see some of the experiments that I've been working with in blue. In particular, here in the Twin Cities, I am like 10 miles away from George Floyd Square. And currently I have a billboard above George Floyd Square that contains a portrait of him with the shades of blue from George Washington Carver's blue. So it's called Blues for George. One of the ways that we can tap into the earth, and one of the things that has been left behind by our grandparents, by our great grandparents, stretching all the way back to Africa, is to take, marshal that, and to use it in a real specific way to continue telling our story. You know, the great theologian Vincent Harding said that stories nourish us. And each one of us now, each one of the folks here has told their story. And, you know, this isn't data. This isn't a whole set of evaluative materials. This is our story. And the thing that we have to share over and over again, and sometimes the burden, and I call it the black tax that weighs on us, especially when we are in those, when you are the only one in that particular environment, that is this burden that weighs heavily on you and adds to the weathering. Those thousand cuts that happen to you over and over and over again. Anyway, all of those stories nourish us and help heal us and can continue to do that.
Thank you for this, too. And that's just beautiful. It brings me back to a quote that that I was thinking about and the start of this, and it says the system that created inequality in terms of pollution, choking our neighborhoods, is the same system that's choking Black people and Brown people when it comes to policing.
Absolutely.
And it was, that's why Dr. Robert Bullard, he's termed the father of environmental justice. Right. But I think what that harkens to, and I think for many of our participants on this call, thinking about that, we know, you know, there is an acknowledgement that the land that they occupy is not that land, not their land, right? Right. You know, they have come to own it by somewhere in the history, a violent repossession of the land, or people have been dispossessed of the land by being forcibly migrated off. And I think this idea of storytelling and truth telling is where it begins to start reconciling, moving beyond, Stefan, what you were saying about stewardship and coming up with a better language to be in relationship with it, but some truth telling, not history telling, but truth telling. And I'm curious if Stefan, Mary, Yvonne, anybody has something that they want to add to that, where to begin with that truth telling story, or and Mary, I may just come back to you on that, but it makes me think it all starts with the relationship, right? It all comes back.
You know, one of the things that Stefan had mentioned were these terms, and we've talked about this before. We suffer through the English language and trying to find these terms that to describe what we do, because there really isn't a term. You know, I describe myself as a visual artist, not necessarily multidisciplinary arts, interdisciplinary arts, on and on and on and on. We can come up with those terms. Not too long ago, the term multiculturalism was used. and that is within my memory. Now, that the pendulum has swung the other way. Somebody told me that, you know, pretty soon it'll go back the other way, white man on top. And it did for a while. I mean, that term came and went. We need now artists and a whole group of folks to be able to come up with another language. And with that, and this gets to what you just said, Lisa, and something that Yvonne touched on as well too, is that in our attempt, and we are just kind of at the beginning of this attempt to transform the world, it means that we need to transform the world order. And in doing that, we need at the same time to come up with something that's not just anti-capitalist, something that's not just anti-racist, but a whole nother model. And with that comes this whole other language. And the last thing I want to say, Lisa, is when we talk about stolen land, is I also need to remind folks that stolen people were brought here to work this stolen land. And that needs to be repaired.
Yes.
And yeah, so anyway.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Mary, did you want to chime in here?
Yeah, I thank you, Setu, for saying that about stolen land and stolen people. I think that is the that's what we need to heal here for us to. Yeah. So I think that's really important. Man, I felt really emotional.
Yeah.
One other point, and then I'm gonna shut up. I mean, Mary, you hit on something. And I mean, you make me cry, but this is that other connection. I mean, as band members that we all have, we're all operating from this deep well of love for ourselves, for our people, and for the land. And with that passion comes all of these emotions that we have to try and deal with. I mean, we need, we all need therapy. We need, you know, there's a psychiatrist, Dr. Mindy Full of Love. You should check out her work if you can. She is a psychiatrist based in New York, at Columbia University, has written a lot about spatial trauma and spatial racism. What she does is not work with individuals, but she helps analyze and then work with entire communities. I mean, we all need to go into deep, deep therapy to cleanse ourselves and to begin to look at this, the world another way. Mm. Now, thank you, Mary.
Mm. Lisa, if I can just share, I think to your point, stories are our most powerful tool. And stories, I know within, you know, my community and also other, really all of our communities, right? As I've learned, but in the Latinx community, there were these ways of moving through our families, our extended families, our friends, that were. If not unconscious, then there weren't words for them, as Mary has pointed out. Dr. Tomás Ibarra Frausto brought them to me and to others in three words, and it just really grounded what was already happening through culture, through expression, through our stories. The first was conocimiento, the importance before anything we share story. We get to know each other, knowledge of others, knowledge of ourselves, convivencia. We live in community, in relation, similar to what Mary shared. And so how are we good neighbors? How are we good guests? And then finally, confianza, right? Like, I'm not good unless you're good. My actions must be cooperative, collaborative, and led with the end goal of mutual benefit. And so these are things that I think have become disconnected, really limited in the spaces that we work, in the systems that we live and work in. And stories help to really close that gap. They both make the issues personal, because there's also an alienation between ourselves and the things we call land, work, right? Like there's compartmentalization of these things. So it both brings together the complexity of those relations and also the inspiration I think that we need to keep going after so much, after such long historic inequities. We need stories to inspire us to keep going. That, I would say, is such an important part of this work, whether you're coming at it from, you know, climate justice or cultural equity, or that has to become more of what we do, as opposed to trying to get to an answer right away. Mm. We really need to avoid that instinct and start with more storytelling and sharing.
I appreciate that, Yvonne. And I really appreciate how I think that is such a beautiful frame. Know each other's stories, how to be a good neighbor, and I'm not good unless you're good, as like these guiding principles. And, you know, in a residency context, we bring people together from all over the world to come together and be in community. But sometimes one of these things is missing, but you can feel the absence of it, right? So if this becomes a guiding principle of how you engage with your colleagues, with your communities, with your families, with your coworkers, with your artists, then all of a sudden it starts to change with your land, right? With the mosquito on your land, the snake in your land, the water, it starts to change. And I think that's a really beautiful invitation. So thank you for offering that up. I really do appreciate that. It's very tight and feels achievable. It feels like something I can do. Stefan, I wanna get you back in here.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, I'd like to try getting back in with the way I heard Yvonne talk earlier about the binary and binaryism, and the word that's come up for everyone else in some part of their speech, they've said the word connection or disconnection. And it just, in the spaces that, it's hard for me to imagine that in the spaces that many of you all work, that you're not either surrounded by or in a world or in a space that's disconnected with people that are disconnected largely. And I don't find that as much in my affinity spaces. I don't find it as much when I'm working with Indigenous folks, not just here, but abroad. But our culture is just rife with that. Our science is rife with that, disconnecting the sciences even, I mean, among themselves, you know, the hard sciences and the physical sciences from the natural sciences and all these, you know, ways that, again, we continue to compartmentalize and separate information or our cultures have done that. And yet, you know, there have been people that have been crossing over these boundaries. Setu talked about George Washington Carver. I mean, I've been listening to Marvin Gaye just a whole bunch recently, you know, and just hearing this person singing about these connections and just going like, how does that get kind of lost or only, you know, it should be so present. Every line of music rings now, and there are so many others. So, you know, I think of Langston Hughes, speaking about our country. So anyway, there's just so much opportunity to connect. And if you aren't part of telling the truth, I don't know. I don't know who could be being the truth tellers. It just that would be, you know, be the thing, you know, I hope, you know, you take from this is the absolute need to recognize that you can be the folks help, you know, always, maybe always have been, except, you know, again, where I think of sort of Anglo-based art, right? I mean, the portraits on the walls, of the domineering, undaunted courage, Lewis and Clark taking, you know, crossing the northern part of the continent, the statues that we have in so many public spaces that are also to colonizers or disruptors and separators. So anyway, sorry, it just feels like this is the space to ask of you all to work on your own healing and maintaining your own resilience at a time where I don't think, both in terms of what's going to happen in nature, but also what's going to happen politically or socially as we move to a global majority. You know, I don't think any of that's going to happen without other kinds of violence or more pushback. So I think telling truth is going to be so necessary, but also may just be that much harder. So.
Thank you for that, Stefan. One of the questions that came up, and I don't know if anyone on the panel or even in the context of our audience wants to get at this, but to start thinking about how can residencies use their resources, their influence and their power to begin to address just address this disconnect between literally the land and the people who occupy it. And I think many of our residencies will tell you that many of them feel, and I don't want to overgeneralize here, but somewhat land rich because, you know, they have a certain amount of either a facility or a certain amount of actual physical and actual space, but are often not cash. They do not have a lot of cash to operationalize that land or that space. And it's often a conundrum. And the question is like, yes, we can host artists, but what else might we be able to do to be able to leverage that platform and leverage that space to grow what we're doing? And I think maybe if each of you just, if you had two thoughts that you would want to share with this group, I think they would be open to hearing that. And it would be really great.
So I worked at Self-Help Graphics and Art in Boyle Heights, Los Angeles. And this is a 50-year-old printmaking workshop that was founded during the Chicano movement in 1971, and has always had the intersection of arts, artists as leaders, creating and community. And we had a program that it was comparably a residency, where we invited artists both locally and nationally to come in for a 3-week period to lead a taller or workshop and atelier. One of the things that, because of the values of the organization and how we approached art and the artist and community as not individual separate things, but things that intersected, coincided, we asked artists to both not only create the work at the organization, but to also work with one of our partner community-based organizations and efforts that they were doing either around healthcare, housing, immigrant services, et cetera. And so they weren't just at the residency at our organization. We also, as an extension, made real, let's say, all of those values that as an organization we operated by. Mm-hmm. If we're thinking about mutual benefit as a lens through which we can look at our programs, our structures, our financial structures as an organization, you know, looking to culturally specific arts organizations that are near you, that may have needs of their own, that kind of collaborative spirit, I think is really important. And I think is a growing, it's a growing need for artists as well. I will say that one of our residencies took us for a ride because we did a call out to a national call out for jornaleros. These are day laborers who are also artists. What we had kind of isolated or forgotten was that they could not fly to our organization. And so we used, right, because we worked cross-sector, we had a really good relationship with the National Day Labor Organizing Network in these various cities. And we used technology to our advantage to create a virtual taller with the help of our partners. And so we've all seen over the past year what how technology has served us, limited us, et cetera. But in this case, it really served us to include a group of individuals and artists who are often left off the grid, that we could include them and their stories and expressions through partnership and through, innovation that came out of necessity, basically. And it was a wonderful project. And so it's not, right, again, land and beyond. Like, how do we create an inclusive framework?
Right.
You know, in answer to your question, Lisa, the artist, Guillermo Gomez Pena, years ago, and I meant to say this when I mentioned multiculturalism, he defined that as sharing a desk, sharing a paycheck, and sharing power. Now that Lisa has broken into the major leagues here, you know, all the other teams that are operating here in this system need to follow suit. You know, there is real talent out there that folks are missing. So you need to hire folks. not just hire them, but embrace, nurture, and maintain those folks and respect that power. That's one thing. Now, the other thing is real simple. Give back some of the land. Figure it out.
I agree with Saitu and Yvonne, and what's, you know, just thinking about what Stefan, I don't think I have an answer to your question, Lisa, but just thinking about what Stefan was saying, that, you know, it's not just one thing, it's not just one space, it's not just one part, like it's everything. Like there is so many, like everything is so intersectional, right? It's the intersectionality, for lack of a better word. But it's just, I just think about, like, we should be looking in places that we wouldn't normally look. We should be considering partnerships that we wouldn't consider, like how might we do this with where it's unexpected, right? Where is the everyday unexpected, and how do we do that to ensure that we're working collectively, right? And being a good relative, but like, just like, so that nobody gets left behind. No, there is no separation of things. Like there isn't something sitting on a little pedestal by itself, right? Like that just doesn't work that way. We have to do it unexpectedly. I mean, yourself as a scientist and an artist, right? Like that is an unexpected thing. Say too, as an archivist and an artist, like that is an unexpected thing. And so I just think it's where it's the everyday unexpected that we need to be working in.
And I'll put out a very pragmatic opportunity. I was on the board of a land trust in the valley. By the way, I live in the land of the lands of the Pequawket people, who are members of the Abenaki tribe and the larger Wabanaki Confederacy in the western part of what we call here in the US, we call Maine. And in across the valley, the land trust that I actually worked for, or worked with, and then was on the board of, the Upper Saco Valley Land Trust has a Art Celebrates Place event. They have found a space to show and highlight local artists. There will be, often they have an event that includes any form of visual and poetry readings and sort of any form of art expression that celebrates the place. And I think that sense of, you know, as far as helping to create the connection for people again and speak truths, I think that one of the difficulties has been to sort of overcome the temptation to turn that into, you know, a fundraiser in the sense that, you know, that it sort of just drives the machinery again. And that's what it's all about. The beauty of this event, thanks to a really unique individual that really, really fought against his board, myself probably included at the time, to make sure that we didn't just turn it into a fundraising event, that it really is more about a connecting event. So that would just be the one caution to it.
Thank you each for that. This has been a beautiful and a wonderful discussion. And it could go on forever. And I think I definitely look forward to a part two, whether it be around a small table or a very large one. But this has been very beautiful and very generous. And we at the Alliance want to say thank you for giving us your time and your wisdom and your expertise in this moment. So I say thank you, and I invite our audience to say thank you as well with deep gratitude. As many of you know, we have been working here at the Alliance. Since I've been here for the past 5 years, equity has been centered in all of our work, and everything that we've been doing has been around how do we embody equity? So it's not thinking about if we're talking about environmental or ecological issues that we're talking about equity in the environment. We're talking about how do you see or how does it show up in everything that you do so that it's not an add-on conversation, but it's central to what you're doing. And through this work, we have really been thinking about how do we bring this to our field and begin to change the inflection of a field. And I thank each of you because I think you have really put a lot of good thinking and thoughts forward. We call this, I came up with a term after working with one of our groups called equitable capacity. And I call it, it's the ability of an organization to strengthen their organization's muscle to be equitable in their policies, processes, and practices, with the capacity being the facility or power to produce, perform, or deploy. What do you do with what you have to be more equitable, fair, and just in your work? And we're really excited to be able to launch into a conversation about climate change, climate crisis, and to have this conversation with you all. For my residency participants, I think you have heard a lot of different things, and there's been a lot of gems and nuggets. I have pages of notes, right? Pages of notes. I had to forget. I was like, I'm supposed to be facilitating, but I'm learning so much in this moment that I don't want to miss an opportunity to write a lot of this down because there was so many beautiful things said. But I want to offer this up to you. If you're following the thread, and if you were thinking like I was thinking, is that really each one of our presenters were telling you how to throw out the colonizer's playbook, right? How do you begin to throw out the colonizer's playbook, right? How do you throw it away and rewrite that playbook? So this idea, if one chapter in the colonizer's playbook is to dismiss or distort the past, they said, start with some truth-telling, honest storytelling, not telling the story or the history that benefits you, but the actual truth, and lay it bear for what it is. And that is really important. Let's end the double speak and deceit. Okay. We use words and terminology to benefit our organizations, to benefit ourselves. We come up with, I'm going to steward the land, meaning that I'm going to own, keep it, and capitalize off of it, versus a change in a position would be, I'm going to be in relationship with the land. So think about that. You know, we're going to stop using double speak and deceit to be able to cover up or dodge the issues that are in front of us. Throw away paternalism, right? Everything is a gift of time and space. This has been bequeathed to me, right? Native Americans gave me this land. There was this peaceful handoff, okay? We're gonna stop talking about the gift in time and space and start talking a little bit more about reciprocity and doing things from places of love and generosity. And I really appreciate it when Say Tu said, start giving land back. Start giving land back. And then we're also going to refute the invisible rule of law, okay? Where everything is being controlled by these past ways of doing things, these systems that we know and structures that are inequitable, that were meant specifically to hold certain groups of people back and to prevent them from prospering and growing under the guise of advancement, growth, and progress. We're going to refute that because we recognize even in the environmental movement, even in thinking about climate change, when we talk about preserving and conserving spaces, that this is one way that that invisible rule of law is weaponized against those folks that are on the margins. And we're going to do that a little bit better. So what I ask each of you is to think about that, revisit the colonizer's playbook, throw it away, take it, these good notes that you have today, and think about how you might rewrite it. What could you do differently? What stories are you going to tell? Where does that truth lie? And who are your partners in this work? How do you build community in talking about that work? How do you know each other's stories? And not just the stories of the people that look like you, that have a shared identity as you, but the other people in your community. How are you a good neighbor? How could you be a good relative? And how do you take on an attitude, I am not good unless you are good. I am not well if you are not well. Remembering, I am because you are. So I thank you all. This has been a beautiful, beautiful session. I appreciate your time and attention. I thank our wonderful, wonderful speakers, Stefan, Mary, Yvonne, and Saytu. You're amazing. And I thank the fantastic Alliance of Artist Communities team, Deb Flan, Edwige, Joelle, and Miranda for always, Zoe, hosting a wonderful, wonderful event. So thank you all. And until next time.